Well, we're really blessed and excited and expectant this morning to have Pastor Matthew and Kristen Buckley with us. Could the two of you just stand? We just want to greet you and welcome you in the name of Jesus. Can we give them a warm Rhema South Coast welcome? And they are the pastors of Light of the World Ministries in Francistown, Botswana. And they went to Rhema Bible School, Tulsa. That's where they did their training. They went as missionaries to Botswana, and they've set up an amazing church. I think you've been there for 27 years, somewhere around 27 years, serving God. They have two sons, Madison and Anderson, and we've got to know them over the last couple of years. They come on holiday down here, and they would attend our church, and over the years, we just became friends, and so I think for the last 3 years, this will be the third year, whenever they're down here, we get together, we have fellowship, or we'll do coffee or lunch, and they're just an awesome couple, serving God, doing a great work, and so we're privileged this morning to have Pastor Matthew come, and he's going to share the word with us. So can we just welcome him as he comes, a gift to the body, and let's enjoy his ministry this morning.
It's good to be here with you this morning. I'm waiting for my interpreter in Botswana. We use an interpreter. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the entrance of your word brings light. I thank you that our hearts are open, ready to receive what you have for us today. I thank you that we're good ground. Lord, I yield myself to the Holy Spirit, to yield my tongue as the pen of a ready writer, to minister your word this morning, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, we've been coming down here for some time. My wife was just saying, how did we find this church in the first place? And I said, I think we looked in the yellow pages. We're on holiday. We've been coming down here for a number of years. And a few years ago, we said, you know, it's Sunday. We'd like to go to church. And so we looked in the phone book. We saw Rhema. Ah, yeah, that's family. Let's go there. So we've been coming here every time we've been on holiday for a few years now. We've just so much appreciated getting to know your pastors and getting to know some of you. Praise the Lord. Well, when we arrived Tuesday night, we had some visitors come to our holiday house where we're staying. We are staying in a house where it's owned by some friends of ours. Who live in Botswana with us, and the actual owner is the mother who lives in Johannesburg, and they let us stay there. And so about 1 o'clock in the morning, I wake up just to go visit the boys' room, not anything, and I just happened to look outside, and I saw two gentlemen in the corner of the yard. And you know, 1 o'clock in the morning, you're kind of like, am I seeing things? And I just stood there by the veranda window. I looked, and it was a bit warm, so I had the door cracked, the security gate locked, by the way. But, and I'm looking, and I see these guys there, and I wonder what they're doing here. So I went to my nightstand. I picked up my phone, and I said, "Ja, Klaris? Ja, goeiemorgen. I know it's 1 o'clock in the morning. There's some chaps here in the yard of the holiday house here. Yeah, we made it to. We're in fine. Yeah, we're here at the South Coast. Are you expecting them? I mean, it's 1 o'clock in the morning, but should I make some tea for them? Should I open the door? Are they friends of yours? You think that happened? No. I won't yell as loud as I did with this microphone on. I might do something to the sound system. Hey, get out of here! I didn't stop for a moment to think, oh, wait a second, I'm not the owner of this house. Maybe they belong here. No, I know guys coming at 1 o'clock in the morning, hiding in the corner of the yard, climbing over the wall. They don't belong there. And I told them in no uncertain terms, they are not welcome. Get out of here. And I wonder if there's some things that we as the body of Christ have been tolerating the intruders that we have been accepting, things that we didn't realize that we have the authority to tell these things to get out of our life. Maybe we're thinking, well, you know, I'm not the owner of this world. I mean, God is God, and maybe I should just pause a moment and say, God, do you want these intruders here? This sickness, this cancer, this AIDS, this poverty, this strife in my home, should I just welcome it? I mean, you know, I mean, everything, if it's here, it must be from you, so should I just welcome it? There's some things that we have been welcoming, perhaps, that we need to be in a habit of not welcoming. Amen. Stay with me. Say, I love the Word of God. I know you've never heard me preach before, but I'm going to preach the Word of God to you today. Amen. Acts chapter 3 and verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms, and Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, Look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankles bones received strength, and leaping up, stood and walked and entered into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Peter and John had an understanding, a revelation of the name of Jesus. Though Jesus had just recently left this earth in his earthly ministry, they understood that they had been given an assignment, that they had been delegated authority to operate the ministry of Jesus to continue through them. And when they said, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk, it was the very same as if Jesus himself was saying, rise up and walk. When we exercise authority in the name of Jesus within the realm, within the scope of Scripture, we are operating the same as Jesus. When I tell sickness to go, it is the same as in the name of Jesus. It's the same, carries the same weight as if Jesus himself is telling it to go. Some of you are going to have to chew on that for a little while. I understand. But when we have been delegated that authority, the ministry of Jesus was never intended to decline or to stop or to slow down. We see in the book of Acts that that ministry was intended to continue throughout the church age, including today. Hallelujah. When he said in the name of Jesus, he was speaking by the authority of Jesus. When the scripture in the New Testament phrase, in the name of, comes from a Greek word, onoma, which means by the authority of. By the authority of. By the authority of Jesus. When we are speaking scriptural commands, I say scriptural commands because we can't use the name of Jesus just however we please, not in line with the Word of God. You just built your house last year, and now your neighbor has built a nicer house, and you're jealous. In the name of Jesus, I would just want that house to fall down. No. Or you single guys see a beautiful, godly young woman that you want to be your wife. In the name of Jesus, I claim her. No, it doesn't work like that. Hallelujah. You don't have authority over someone else's will. Amen. If you believe that it's God's will, you can pray, believe God for favor. And if God speaks to her heart as well, then something could happen. Amen? Hallelujah. But you don't have authority over someone else's will. We don't have authority outside of the realm of Scripture. But what's promised in the will of God, the will of God is revealed in the Word of God. And when the will of God has been revealed to us through the Word of God, we have to enforce that. I love what Pastor Larry said, fighting the good fight. It's not a fight that we're trying to win. It's a good fight because it's really essentially, legally already been won. We are the enforcing, occupying army. Amen? And we enforce that through our words. Hallelujah. Are you with me? In the name of Jesus means by the authority of. Going to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. We were put on this earth originally with the intention of walking in dominion. That is God's intention for us to walk in this earth having dominion and exercising dominion. Luke chapter 10. And the 70 returned from verse 17. Luke 10, 17. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power. Or that first word, power, some translations rightly translate that authority. To tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. If you've already been taught this, I'm going to remind you. If you have not been taught this, I'm going to mind you the difference between authority and power. Power, we understand what power is essentially, but authority is delegated power. It's not power that originates from yourself, but power that has been delegated. Power that you have been authorized to operate in. So when I'm standing against the enemy, when I'm standing against sickness or anything that's not in line with the Word of God, I'm not standing in my own power, I'm standing in the authority that's been given to me through the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. In legal terms, we call it power of attorney. Years ago, when we first came to Botswana, we left America in 1988. We needed to have someone in America that could handle stateside affairs. If there was any emergency, if there was any kind of bills that needed, even bills that needed to be paid, things that could be taken care of when we're way over here. And a lot of things can be done now electronically. And we didn't even have a fax machine in 1988. So praise the Lord. Email, didn't know what that was. So we had someone who was given, a good friend of ours, who was given power of attorney over our account. I'm still a young man, but as a very young man, the lawyer said to me, now, are you sure you want to do this? Do you know this person very well? Yes, we know them, we trust them. And for all those years, in fact, it's only recently, like this year, we changed accounts and we realized we probably don't need to do that anymore as in this day and age. We changed accounts for a different reason. But all those years, she had power of attorney over our account. She never misused it. She never abused it. She was very trustworthy. But power of attorney means this lady can sign on our account the same as I can. That's why the lawyer was like, are you sure? I wonder if some angels, when you know we're standing around with God, say, are you giving them these people? We've been watching them for years. Are you sure that's a good idea? But I think it speaks highly of how God esteems us and what he trusted us with, that we can come to understand and appreciate the authority that's been delegated to us. Matthew 18, 18, verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. I think we got this the other way around sometimes. We thought that whatever God allows in heaven, we're going to have to allow in earth. Whatever he disallows in earth, we're going to disallow. But this word to bind literally means to disallow. To loose means to permit. So you could read it like this. Verily I say unto whatsoever things you shall disallow on earth shall be disallowed in heaven. Whatsoever you shall permit on earth shall be permitted in heaven. Hold on to your chairs for a second. Are you ready? Not everything that happens in the world is God's will. Think about it. Not everything that happens is God's will. Of course we wish that it was. He told us to pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we want God's will to be done. But let's understand that not everything that happens in the world is God's will. And we have this kind of a passive tendency. We, to just say, well, you know, there must be God. If it happened, it must be God. Not necessarily. And rest assured that if things that are happening that are not God, God is still on the throne, and God is still able to work through those things and take us through, and God is still the King of Kings, He's still the Lord of Lords. Amen. But we have a tendency to just think, well, whatever happens will happen. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. Oh, sorry, sorry. Some of you old enough to remember that song. Whatever will be, will be. If it's happened, it's just going to happen. And there's nothing that we can do about it. Are you still holding on to your chairs? Let's read Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Now, some people, this is their favorite verse. And I understand it's a good verse, but I want to make sure we understand it completely. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, now, and we know that all things work together for good, to them that love God, and to them who are called according to His purpose. All things work together for good. Is that in the Bible? We just read it. That's in the Bible. That is true. But let's make sure that we don't misunderstand what that's saying, that because all things work together for good, that God made it all happen. God didn't cause it, but if God, these are things that are happening, whatever happens, whether it's my mistake, yeah, whether it's somebody else's mistake, whether it's the devil that's behind it, or whether it's God, all these things can work together for good to those who love Him, who are called according to His purpose. That is Scripture. Amen? But we have this tendency to interpret that, to say, well, whatever happens, well, you know, it all works together for good, meaning that God must have caused it to happen for our good. No? And there's some things that we're tolerating and that we're saying, well, you know, there's some people here in the yard and I'm not sure if maybe we should just invite them in. And there's some things that we know. I mean, I know what kind of church this is. I know your background, we're, you know, the same heritage. I know where you're coming from. We know that sickness is not our lot in life. Amen. We know that the price has been paid for sickness. Do people get sick? Yeah. Do Christians get sick? Yes. But is it the will of God? No. Amen. Let me put it like this. It is never, ever God's will for any kind of sickness to be in your life. But it happens. So what we're doing then is we're interpreting our circumstance according to, we're interpreting the Word of God according to our circumstance instead of interpreting our circumstance according to the Word of God. It's true that our bodies don't line up with the Word of God. A couple weeks ago, I was coughing for, I mean, too long, like a couple weeks, just wouldn't stop coughing. But all the time I would say, well, you know, this coughing is just to keep me humble, you know, and just, you know, nah, just everybody has to get sick once in a while. The whole time I was standing against it, it's gone now, but I didn't just accept that. Praise the Lord. You get aches and pains in your body and say, well, you know, it's just, you know, part of, you know, our age. We just have to accept it. Mm-mm. Hallelujah. Yeah, I'm going to be 50 this year, so I know a little bit about that. I know quite a few of you are saying, oh, you're just a child, I know. But Romans 8:26, likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities. Let's go back up to verse 26, look at the context. Helps our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit, should say Himself, maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good. You have to put this together with the verses above it. All things work together for good in the context of prayer. All these things, through prayer, we know that God will cause all things to work together for good. God has a plan for your life, but the enemy also has a plan for your life. And I know some people are so focused upon the devil, they think that everything's a demon and just so demon conscious, and everything, every problem in your life means you need to get deliverance, and we believe in deliverance, but that's not the reason for every problem. Amen. Are we on the same page? We're okay. All right. But the Bible also says not to be ignorant of the enemy's devices. And sometimes I've been, you know, experiencing different kinds of challenges and things coming against us, and it's like, oh, that's the devil. Hey, wait a minute. Great revelation. This isn't God, this is the devil. And you start to realize there's an assignment that needs to be dealt with the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You still holding on to your chairs? Say, I love the Word of God. Here's a lot of Christians' favorite expression, and I hope I don't get in trouble here. God is in control. Everything, I mean, and people say that all the time. God is in control. But we have a tendency to say that when all hell is breaking loose. We have a tendency to say that when, you know, my dog is sick and money is, you know, the tide is just, when everything's going bad, we say, oh, but at least God is in control. Now, when things are going well, we say, oh, hey, look at me. Thank you, Lord. But yeah, my faith, I did this. It's all up to me. But when things are not going well is when we have a tendency to say God is in control. Now, if you use that in the right context, God is sovereign. Amen. We sang a beautiful song, lovely scriptural song about the sovereignty of God. But let's examine for a moment what sovereign means. I took this from a dictionary, so we understand just the common usage of this word. Sovereign, it's an adjective having supreme rank, power, or authority. Preeminent, indisputable, greatest in degree, utmost or extreme, being above all others in character, importance, in excellence. So can we say God is sovereign? Absolutely. God is sovereign. Now, some people want to make a discussion about is God sovereign or is he not sovereign. That, there's no question about that. God is sovereign. But let's make sure we understand what that entails and appreciate what it means that God is sovereign. God has sovereignly established in his word what he will do and what he will not do. So, well, God is sovereign, so if he wants to make me sick, then he can make me sick. No, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. God does not contradict himself because he is sovereign. This helps me to appreciate even more just how sovereign he is, because he is not changing. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Psalm 119, verse 99, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. This consistency of knowing that God stays with his word and is true to his word gives me a confidence. It gives me it builds my faith. It helps me to understand that God is not going to do this one day and be like this one day and be like that another day. That helps me to appreciate even more the sovereignty of God. Because he is sovereign, he has sovereignly established what he will do and what he will not do. He has sovereignly revealed his character. He has sovereignly established promises, and he has sovereignly delegated authority to the church. Hallelujah. So this understanding doesn't diminish the sovereignty of God. It exalts his sovereignty. I think it helps us to appreciate God is more sovereign than we thought. He's not sovereign to the place where he can do one thing one day and another thing the other day. He himself has sovereignly established and said what he will do and what he won't do. You know there's some things that God cannot do? We just read it. God cannot lie. Amen? And who said he cannot lie? Did I say he cannot lie? No, of course. Did Pastor Larry say that he can't lie? God himself said that he cannot lie. God himself has established that he cannot lie. So these promises, these things that God has put in place, he himself is the one who said it. So it's not that, well, I'm overriding his sovereignty by asking for this. If I know what the will of God is revealed in the Word of God, I'm not overriding him. I'm coming in agreement with him. Amen. There are some things that we don't know specifically the will of God. We have to pray and ask God to show us what his will is. The Bible says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord, but the Bible does not say Matthew Buckley, Mary Kristen Mickelson. Amen. My pastor, Kenneth W. Hagin, said, turn around and shake hands. I'm not going to imitate him. Turn around and shake hands with someone next to you. And I turned around and there she was. And I said, will you marry me? No, not quite like that. But over a course of time, we got to know each other and we both realized it was the will of God. We've been married since 1988. Hallelujah. If you don't know what the will of God is, you can ask him. But I think we understand we don't pray every prayer, if it be thy will. Amen. If we know what the will of God is, we don't have to say if. James 1:13 says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Going down to verse 16, it says, do not err, beloved brethren. In other words, apparently people make this mistake. Back then they were making this mistake, and a lot of people make this mistake today. Do not err, beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Hallelujah. Every good gift is from above. Hallelujah. Is cancer a good gift? Well, we could bring some preschool kids in here and say, is cancer a good gift? No. But, God and his sovereignty and his wisdom and his ways are above our ways. We just don't know that sometimes these things can be a good gift. It's not a good gift. Oh, but Pastor, let me tell you my testimony. When I was in the hospital with cancer, I was backslidden, and some people came and witnessed to me, and I got back right with God. And while I was there, I witnessed with other people, and they got born again. And you know, I just know that God is the one who gave me this cancer so all these things could happen. No. All things work together for good, it's true. God can take whatever happens and turn it around for good, amen? But it doesn't mean that he caused it, and it doesn't mean that we should just roll over and accept it. You've all seen, you know, dogs, you know, and they roll over on their back, and they, I don't want to fight, just scratch my belly. I'm not going to fight you, no. Dogs do that when they're, you know, fighting with each other, and then one of them just, I'm done fighting, I give up. Just scratch my belly. But we can't be like that. I just take whatever comes, just I give up, I surrender. No. Misunderstanding the sovereignty of God, not knowing what the will of God, causes a passivity, causes a unwillingness to stand up and take hold of what belongs to us. Hallelujah. Say, I'm a fighter. It is actually not a biblical philosophy, this que sera, sera. It's involved in many other religions. Most Eastern religions embrace this, karma, good luck, just going to happen. I'm not an expert in Islam. I do teach a class in comparative religions, but my understanding of Islam is that kismet, the will of God, the will of Allah, whatever happens generally is accepted. It must be the will of Allah, and nothing's going to happen unless it's the will of Allah. Where do we bring that over into the body of Christ? It's not a biblical fatalism is what it's called in philosophical terms. Fatalism. Whatever's going to happen is going to happen. There's some things that have happened because we didn't know that we were supposed to exercise our authority and put our foot down and say, I am going to disallow this. I am not going to permit this. Hallelujah. James 4:7, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. There are certain things that God has assigned for us to do. In other words, understand this. There are things that we cannot do without God. And there are things that God cannot do without his body. We are the body of Christ, are we not? Are we called the body of Christ? Is that just a cute phrase? What does that mean? We are the body of Christ. And the body cannot operate without the head. And the head cannot operate in the earth without the body. That is our assignment. Well, if God wants to do something about it, he'll do something about it. But you have been assigned to do something about it. I have been assigned to do something about it. With authority comes responsibility. Hallelujah. Now, you could take this like, oh, that means that every bad thing that's happened in my life, it's all my fault, and I just messed up, and I just let this happen. No, stop. We don't have to look back and say, well, why did I let this happen? But from now on, once we begin to get a revelation of this and begin to walk in this revelation and this understanding, we can stop allowing things that we should not have been allowing. Hallelujah. Smile. See if you, this is good news. If somebody gives you a key, don't say, oh, I didn't know I had to use a key. What's this key for? Oh, I thought I could just do it without a key. I just gave you a key. The Word of God has given us a key. Hallelujah. Philippians 2:9, wherefore God has also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Let us rise up as the body of Christ and exercise our authority. And when we see things trespassing, coming into our lives that are not supposed to be there, say, in the name of Jesus, I disallow this. I will not allow this sickness in my home. I will not allow this strife in my home. I'm not going to allow the enemy to wreak havoc in my finances. In the name of Jesus, I'm going to exercise authority. I'm not going to just roll over and let the devil just have his way in my life. There's things that we have to submit to the will of God. There's tough things that we need to pass through. But if it's not in line with the Word of God, if it's something that our covenant has provided for us, let's not accept it. Let's not take it. If it's not of God, don't accept it. By his stripes you were healed. You know, we just had Christmas when our boys were little. Sometimes you go and spend a lot of money on a Christmas present. You think, I hope they're going to play with this toy. I hope they're going to enjoy it. I hope I'm going to get my money's worth. Now, this might sound like kind of a silly example, but to think of the great price that Jesus has paid for our healing. When he took 39 stripes upon his back. And said, well, thanks. I appreciate that. That was nice of you, but I think I'll just keep this sickness. Wait a second. It's kind of sober, I know, but think about that. If somebody has paid a great price, that through his poverty, we have been made rich. At the cross, it doesn't mean that he became poor when he came to the earth, but when he came to the earth, immediately on Christmas, on the day he was born, we'll say Christmas Day, the day he was born, they came with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. He was endowed financially and set up well to minister. Praise the Lord. Well, he didn't have a home. He didn't need a home. He was always traveling constantly. There was no need at that point for him to settle down and to maintain a permanent residence. He was in full-time traveling ministry for about 3.5 years. No need for him to have a house. But God, his Father, took good care of him. Through his poverty at the cross, when he came there, he was stripped of all of his earthly possessions. We have been made rich. Praise the Lord. I know the way some people teach prosperity, it just sounds like, gosh, is that all there is? It's just all about money? No, it's not just all about money, but money is a part of it. Prosperity is a part of it. If we understand the purpose of prosperity and what it's all about, we want to take full advantage of what God has provided for us, amen, and not just allow the devil to have his way in our finances. Enforce the victory that Jesus has provided for us. Hallelujah. Enforce it. And don't settle for things that God doesn't want you to settle for. There's some tough things. I mean, there's challenging things we need to go through, but not things that are part of our covenant. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.